Thank you. the case when you're looking at these other changes. So questions of future studies. These are my sort of biases and things that I think are going to be important to do in the future. One question is, does low-dose radiation exposure alter the DNA genome? Remember, all of this is done in mice, and we've only looked at one metastatic epithelium. Another big question, if yes, are the changes in the epithelium inherent and transgenerationally? It's a big, big issue. Big question. So how do you do this? I believe that the best population for populations for addressing these critically important questions are going to be the Hiroshima and Nagasaki atomic bomb survivors and their offspring. These are available, and I think we have to take seriously about looking at them from the standpoint of their physical modifications. I now want to end this as the last slide, with a slide that I call food for thought, something that you'll be able to chew on and think about after you leave this lecture. One of them is a quote by a physicist, and the other by a philosopher. The physicist is John Cannon. He was successful in developing the first solid-state lithium fluoride radiation detector system and also started the very first radiation health physics department at the UW. And later towards the end of his life, he wrote this: I am now almost certain that we need more radiation for better health. And the second quote, what does not kill me makes me stronger. Thank you. Any questions?
Right now, we, how can we use the genetic tools to try to determine are there certain interventions that we can do to Thank you. Are not degraded at all, but others are very, very strongly affected. Some of the others are very strongly affected.
hourly growth rates due to degeneration and translational depression independent of each other, or degeneration is a consequence of translational depression. Heavy first, so I'll address this later, and also mechanism of the depression itself. How does the disease affect the stress? What factors are recruited by ABO and CRP-related proteins, and how do they affect processes? So I need to introduce two main players in the topic. Those are proteins of argonaut acting. Argonaut proteins associate directly with microRNA, and there's some structural information available. The pockets behind the 5-metric of microRNA have been structured. This might the four proteins panels, argonauts 1 to 4, and these are multi-domain proteins, so key domains meaning NTDB and TASH, which recognize different elements in microRNA. And the second family unit for the proteins are GW-19 proteins. GW stands for glycine tryptophan, which the three parallels of panels, protein house 6A, D, and C. And the function of other protein is actually to bring the GW protein to the complex. So and this interaction occurs in the mid domain of argonaut protein, and GW repeats present in the terminus of this domain. So what happens is that there are layers of interactions. MicroRNA has to bring other protein, the message, other protein, the CW982. And then the question remains, so what is the next step in this? How translation is regressed, how the degradation is brought about. And I just want to show you a summary of research done by Austin of two other groups studies recently. We could show that GW982 proteins in this region recruit a large complex known as a CCR4-NOT complex, which actually is involved in both translational depression and mRNA degradation followed by degradation. So what is this complex? This is a highly conserved complex conserved in yeast and humans, consisting of about 10 subunits. It contains two mRNA degradases, CAF1 and CCR4. It also has a role in transcription. One of the subunits, NOT4, is a ubiquitin ligase, and three of this complex has cytoplasmic and nuclear function. It is a very, very important complex with having major effects on gene expression, certainly very, very much on the study complex. But now, because of the connection with microRNA expression, people started to study very intensively. So, how is this complex recruited by GW982? I want to spend a few minutes on that because this is kind of interesting story. So, as I told you, by the initial analysis of proteins of the human GW982 proteins, we originally identified two regions which are involved in the repression of protein synthesis by this protein, the internal part of the external part genes. And by further mutational analysis, we could identify subregions in these two internal and external regions which are key for the repression. And here are some paradoxes, because this protein, our narrow region, this is the most conserved part of the protein in terms of the sequence, but this is absolutely unessential. Hansel plays a super parallel. What is important are the sequences in between, called M2 and C-term. And on the internal part, there's another region. And when the stars here indicate here and here are repeats of the tryptophanes, followed or preceded by glycine, serine, or threonine. And these three regions are key for repression and CCR4-NOT binding. Those regions are disordered. So the sequence prediction and also some antibody studies within the collaboration find that there's no any structure in these regions. So they're all disordered. And this element, tryptophan, which element, they are redundant. So for instance, we have a N2 sequence or C-term sequence and an anti-effect of the whole region. So as I told you, absolutely has some stimulatory role. So I want to show you one example of the experiment, how we prove that tryptophanes, this thirst to this non-structured features are contributing to the regression. So when we take a wild-type sequence and tether it to mRNA, we see about 10-fold inhibition of protein synthesis. So from this level to that level. If we take single tryptophanes, any of those, we don't see an effect. But when we start to introduce increasing amount of mutations of tryptophanes, this plus this, so we still see some effect, three more effect, and if we take 7 or 8, we completely eliminate the regression. And we also eliminate interaction with the CCR4-NOT complex. So those are just examples of two subunits of the complex, CAF1 and CNOT1. When we have wild-type sequence, these two proteins are pulled down. When we take away tryptophanes, the interaction is gone. And the same applies to the NTDB domain. When we take the one which I was showing the previous slides coming from the terminus, we find the same effect. Tryptophanes are needed for both repression and CCR4-NOT binding. And what is most important is that these motifs also function in the context of human GW-182 proteins and during genuine microRNA and even depression, because many experiments are showing so far they involve entering of fragments or mutants of the protein in RNA. But by doing different genetic and biochemical tests, we can knock down endogenous proteins and introduce mutants to the cell and show that activity depends on the endogenous proteins, depends on the circulating proteins. Of course, we were very much worried by this experiment that when we take 7 or 8 tryptophanes, even in non-structured regions, we can mesh out with this protein fragment by lots, and we were interested in doing kind of gain of function experiment to show that the tryptophanes are really not working by distorting the secondary structure or activity or floating the protein, but that they genuinely play a role in the repression. So what we did, we decided to test whether any disordered protein will eat. This was an example. Retaining repressive potential after the insertion of tryptophan residues next to glycine, serine, or threonine. So here's a fragment of the yeast protein, SIG1, which is more structured, so the structure studies are performed on this protein. And what we did here, just inserted, shown in red, a couple of tryptophanes into the sequence, specially inserted into these mutations, creating GW or GW reduced in protein. And we really gain the repressive potential. So when we insert more, we see partial repression. When we insert 7, we have more repression. And what is even more important, when we insert those tryptophanes, this protein, the control protein, doesn't pull down CAF1 and CNOT1. That's not the complex. But the protein can this tryptophan insert it, starts to pull down the protein. This is all complex. So this was a very important experiment for us to actually
Thank you.
fashion of micronation, semi-nation addition, and degradation. And this is actually hard to understand that this would be the case, because there are many examples in literature coming from not genomic studies or licensing programs in the whole genome, but in individual RNAs, where body seeing RNAs are repressed by microRNAs at the translational level without considering the degradation of mRNA. And here is something important to mention, now that perhaps the fact that a certain complex, CCR or not, is responsible for deamination of mRNA and translational repression, there is somehow what this might be speculating that depending on cell type or microRNA or message, either activity of this complex in DNA or repressed translation will be long to require the amount of again go back and forth between different activities of the same complex. So this is just what that I've been discussing. Another point which I want to make is that there's layers of interactions about, you know, the microRNA traffic, how the traffic GDAM 182, GDAM 182, a traffic CCR or not, and who knows how many factors are already in between, creates a lot of possibilities to regulate the process. If one thinks about microRNA regulation, as a pathway affecting more than half of the genes per cell, this is perhaps not unexpected that this complexity, starting from post-translational modification and proteolysis, is there, nothing to allow kind of limited stages of definition. So I would like now to move to the second part, the regulation of microRNA against repression and response. So I only very briefly want to mention the work which we did on the regulation of microRNA repression per se. There are thousands of regulatory proteins now identified which modulate the repression of the microRNAs. Hodgkin's 2008 established that the two proteins are the next microRNA and mRNA. There's also a very strong post-translational modifications, so we still don't understand the biology, but all these proteins are post-translationally modified, ubiquitinated, hydroxylated, or phosphorylated, and have got displaced and control in the regulation. And finally, the reverse lift of microRNA repression. As 1.5 years ago when we started to do this experiment, it was only known that microRNAs bind to mRNA and repress mRNA as a kind of final decision, especially that microRNA was degraded, that was an official order. So we reasoned that the process would be actually much more important microdynamic when under some conditions, microRNA repression could be reversed, and we'd go back and forth. And we found that in hypothesized, microRNA 132 was delivered right upon the reverse clinic. MicroRNA, it represses mRNA and coding cationic amino acid transporter by binding to 3'ER, and the repressed mRNA is located in the people when it restores, without any delays, and not its mRNA. And then we noticed that out of stress, this may be ER stress, amino acid starvation, or oxidative stress, H2R, an RNA binding protein, is getting out of the nucleus, binds to the 3'ER, and it causes 3D protein repression. So mRNA is departing from the T-bodies and recruited the polysomes for translation. And just want to show one example of the data, so I think that here in a cell wrong, in the presence of amino acids, the repression RNA is present in T-bodies. When you start cells for amino acids, the T-bodies are still there, but the mRNA is gone, and it is associated with polysomes. So this process is H2R dependent, so when you knock down H2R, this doesn't happen. And treatment is anti-1-2, anti-sensual ecological immunity, this is phenotype. So this is indicated by microRNA repression being created. And H2R, so just to introduce you briefly to this protein, I'm talking about here with it because these are both papers, NIH, but not at this conference, in studying this protein very intensely, is an RNA binding protein which binds to ARU elements, the rich elements of 3'ER, used to study lysis proteins. It's mainly localized in the nucleus, but shackles between the nucleus and the cytoplasm, and translocated from the nucleus to cytoplasm in response to stress. And these proteins are regulated and accumulate in cytoplasm and in conscience. So, the cotoxin demonstrates that we can mediate this protein, the activity of this protein in absence of stress. So, we can uncouple this effect from stress because originally it was very hard to predict what the stress conditions and what kind of changes they would be using the cell. So, by using H2R demons and conscious cells in the cytoplasmic H2R, we could show that cytoplasmic location of H2R is actually sufficient for the effect. And more recently, we were interested in the mechanism how this protein actually is mediating this effect. And we could show that actually this protein, when binding to 3'ER, displaces the microRNA from mRNA, and it does it because it only realizes the local message. And how exactly does it physically displace microRNA? This we don't know. I have no time to show this. This may have been recently published, but I think that was where I've seen it in a lab. So I want to finish this part with just telling you that the interplay between microRNAs and RNA binding proteins binding to different regions in the 3'ER is a very common phenomenon. There are thousands of examples of this. So this slide always was the first, and this can work in different directions. RNA binding proteins can have a positive effect on repression and negative, and vice versa. MicroRNAs can have a positive or negative effect on RNA binding proteins, and this can be due to different mechanisms. Very often, microRNAs and RNA binding proteins just compete for the same sequence to bind to. So just 3'ER can have very often very long, and there are hundreds of RNA binding proteins and hundreds of microRNAs. You can imagine how common this type of co-regulation will be. I want to then move to the regulation of biogenesis, just by telling you that there are many factors which modulate biogenesis of microRNAs. And this type of Rosa processing or Dyson processing. And these proteins include proteins like P53, SNAP and H1P proteins, phenylalanine, P16, helicases, D20, 28, and oncogene. So there are many, many examples of these proteins binding to the UC proteins of microRNA precursors, either in the nucleus, and then they affect Rosa processing in a positive or negative way, or in a cytoplasm, where they affect in a positive or negative way processing by Dyson. This is taken from an article published some time ago by the collaboration of Sergio Liberici and Michael Rosenthal. I want to now just look at the final piece of experiments I want to discuss, the regulation of microRNA decay. MicroRNAs are generally unique in very stable molecules, very long lived, with their half-lives extended into days. Even there are examples of microRNAs are in the human change their levels over days. So we actually started to investigate this problem in retina. We were interested, I have a very good colleague, especially in the specialist in retina physiologist in Asia, Professor Oscar, as we decided at one point to combine forces and look at micro-NH, which responds to light or dark penetration. So we did a set of experiments where we're giving mice dead mice. We're moving them after 3 hours in light of the dark and collecting samples of mice kept in light or in dark. And we did sequencing of this protection real time ECR like on the RS. And we came up with a couple of micro-NH, which actually decreased during this 3 hours of dark about 2.5 to 3.5 fold, which was something I've heard of, that micro-NH would be going down sort of rapidly at the time. So this was done a couple of years ago and published recently, but now there are more examples of micro-NH that we can recover.
Collaborate with many people, including Donald Schoenberg, Gerhard Schwartz, and also
other people and other churches as a part of their mission is the way that we are not the only one who is working in this field. This is a very competitive field, and there are many studies done by some other democracy, so these are one of them, actually, we're all the time in the synodal conclusions, which is actually very good because the normal countries are already studies about one group can have a cure, the results of other groups. So the fact that three groups identified by CCR.com as the most common is something unheard of. It's like our first group based on our secret heading. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
coalition, they can continue with their traditions and things. And throughout all of this work, the thousands of years that you've been studying mind-brain relationships, I have assured to you that it's only a generalization. I think it is critical to true without discussion, like it's one exception, but basically, for all the long period, advances in neuroscience have been of one impact.
Thank you. I in the
Well-worked out models of how the way you did stuff in psychological stuff. There was no coalition over people.